Ambient occlusion is awesome, so today let's learn how to use it with texture baking. Hey everyone and welcome back to Texture Baking Mastery. Today we're going to be baking some texture maps for this object I made here, and we're also going to be baking an ambient occlusion map, and then I'm going to show you how to use all those maps in conjunction with each other to create some really cool results. So to get started, let's left click our object here. Of course, to follow along, you can just use the file in the description of this module, so just left click that to download it. And then if you unzip it, you'll be able to open up this file here. To get started, we'll bake the base color. So I'm going to press Shift A, and then under texture, I'm going to choose image texture, and I'm going to press plus new, and then I'm just going to call it diffuse brick. And I'm going to make it a 2K texture. So I'm just going to left click and then quickly drag down. Then I'll left click the last bit here, and then I'm going to hold down Shift and type the number 8 to get a star sign, then 2, and then press Enter. And that's going to perform a timesing operation and times that by 2, creating the number 2048, and then I can just go ahead and press New Image. Then we're going to keep our color space on sRGB, since this is going to be the base color texture. Now, a little bit about this object here. If I press Tab to go into Edit Mode, what I've done here, as some of you might have noticed, is a cube projection. So to get this result, all I done was I pressed U, and then I chose Cube Projection. And that's allowed us to place this procedural material on it nicely. However, this won't really work for texture baking. The main reason why is because the ambient occlusion relies a lot on the structure of the object, and so it's best for all of the faces to be separated out. So although some of the texture bakes will work, the ambient occlusion one will not. So for that reason, we're going to bake onto a different UV map, which might be less optimal for the base color, roughness, and normal map, but it'll be more optimal for the ambient occlusion. Of course though, if you really wanted to maximize, you could just bake onto the cube projection for the base color, roughness, and normal map, and use the other UV map for the ambient occlusion. However, I don't think all 3D software support two UV maps, so this might be something you'll only be able to do inside of Blender. So it really depends on your project's needs. For simplicity's sake though, we will just do it all onto a second UV map. So if I come to this green triangle here, we will need to preserve this UV map here, as we need this in order to tell Blender how our brick material looks. So I'm going to press the plus button to add a second UV map, and I'm going to then left click it to make sure it's blue, like this. Then I can press Tab to go into Edit Mode in the 3D viewport. I'll press A to select everything, then I'll press U, and then I'll choose Smart UV Project. Make sure all these settings are the same, including the island margin of 0.01, and then I'll just choose Unwrap. If I zoom in here, this is the unwrap we've been given, and you can see this will give us plenty of space for us to get some ambient occlusion in here. Then I'm going to keep it selected, and then if I come to my render properties, I'll make sure I'm in Cycles, and I'll set my max samples to 10 since we're not doing any ambient occlusion yet. And then I'm going to scroll down to the bottom and make sure my bake type is set to diffuse. Turn off the direct and indirect since we don't want any lighting. And then I'll just go ahead and press bake. Awesome, and once we're finished here, we should have a result like this. Since everything is a little bit smaller, if you're wanting to go for really high detail, 4K texture maps may be a better option for you. But for now, I'm just going to keep it on 2K. Then I'm going to left click my texture here and press Shift D to duplicate. And I'm going to press the cross to get rid of this, and then I'll press plus new, and this one I'm going to call roughness brick, and then I'm going to press new image and change it from color space to non-color. Also, we need to save our base color image, so I'm going to come up to where it says image with star beside it, left click it, and then I'm going to choose save. Then in my file browser here, I'm going to create a new folder, and I'm just going to call it brick 2K textures, and since this is the second time we're making brick textures in this folder, I'm just going to put 2 after it since it's the second one. And then I'm just going to double click it to open it, and then I'll just choose save as image here. Then I'm going to left click my roughness brick texture, and I'm going to scroll down to my bake settings here and change my bake type to roughness. And then I can go ahead, make sure my settings are the same, make sure my objects are selected and my roughness brick texture, and then just press bake. Awesome, now we have our roughness image. We can just go ahead and left click image and then choose save. And then in my folder here, I'm just going to press save as image. Then now we'll go ahead and do the normal. So I'll just left click this roughness brick here, and I'll press Shift D to duplicate. Then I'll press X to remove it from here, plus new. And I'm just going to call this OpenGL normal brick. I'll keep my width and height at 2K. And then I'm just going to press new image, and I'll change my color space here to non-color. Then we can go ahead and change our bake type here to normal, and then we can go ahead and press bake. Awesome, and now we have our normal map, so we can go ahead and left click image and then choose save. And then I'm just going to press save as image inside my file browser. And there, now we have our base textures. Let's go ahead and do the ambient occlusion. So I'm going to change my bake type here from normal to ambient occlusion. And of course, we'll need a texture to bake onto. So I'll just left click one of these and press Shift D to duplicate. And I'll press the X to get rid of it. Press plus new. And I'm going to call this AO brick. I'll keep it at 2K, and then I'm going to press new image, and I'm going to change the color space here to non-color. Then I'm going to come up to the top here, and for my max samples here, I'm just going to set it to something higher, like 100, as it will need a bit more of a lighting calculation for ambient occlusion. However, if you're not satisfied with the result, I recommend setting it to something higher. You can also keep the noise threshold and denoise on to improve the result a little bit. Then I'll scroll down and I'm just going to left click bake. Great, and when it's done, it should look something like this. And so we can just go ahead and save this. So I'll left click image and I'll choose save as or save. And then I'm just going to go ahead and press save as image in my file browser. And awesome, now we have all of our image textures. And now I'll show you how we can actually use them. So I'll left click my object here and press shift D to duplicate. Then I'm going to press G and X and then pull this along. Since we got all our textures in here already, I'm just going to left click this button here, this add a new material thing, which actually just duplicates this material. And then I can just left click this big shader and press X. And we still need a shader. So I'm just going to press shift A and then under shader, I'm going to choose principal BSDF, which is this default shader here and also the best shader in my opinion. And I'm going to plug the BSDF into the surface and then we can start plugging these in. So to get started, let's take the diffuse brick. And if I press shift A and then under input, I'll choose texture coordinate. So we can use the UV coordinates and I'll plug UV into vector and then color into base color. And you'll see right now it's going to be using the other UV. So what we can do is we can come to our green triangle and we can either left click this camera here to use the other UV map, or for simplicity's sake, we can just remove the other one. So this is the cube projection one on top. I'll just left click the minus and that's gotten rid of it. Next up, we have the roughness. So I'll plug the UV into the vector of this one and then I'll plug this color into the roughness. Then we have our OpenGL normal map. So I'll just drag this down here and I'm going to plug the UV into the vector here. And then we need to use a normal map node in order to use this normal map with our shader. So I'll press shift A, then under vector, I'll choose normal map and I'll plug my color into the color and then normal all the way into the normal socket. And awesome, now we have our basic brick PBR textures applied. Let's talk about how we can actually use this ambient occlusion one. So first of all, I'll take my UV coordinates and plug it into the vector. And then I'm going to left click and drag it to just pull it up here as we're going to be combining it into the base color. So we have a couple of options. We can either use this as a mask or we can use it as a multiply. So the first way I'm going to show you is the mask method. So I'll press shift A and then under color, I'm going to choose mix color. And then I'm just going to left click this here for now. And if you've watched my masks and mixing nodes video, you'll know that we can use black and white textures, such as this one here, to control what goes in this A and B socket of our mix node. So if you don't know what masks are, I highly recommend watching that video as it's kind of essential to understand what we're talking about here. I'll leave that linked in the resources section of this module. I'll then plug the color into the factor. And now what we can do is if I drag my result into the surface to see what it looks like, we can now use these two colors to control what our ambient occlusion looks like. So B is going to represent the white areas here and A is going to represent the more darker areas. So if I want to make the darker areas darker, I can left click the A color and bring down the slider. And you can see how that's making the darker areas darker like that. So that's the basics of how it works, but how do we use it with our base color? Well, what I like to do is I'll plug my color into A of my diffuse brick, and then I'll also plug it into the B socket as well. That will then reset it to the default. And then what we can do is we can press shift A, then under color, I can choose hue saturation value, and I can plug that in between the A. The reason I'm choosing A is because I want to make this part darker using this hue saturation value node. So this node will allow me to adjust the value. So value is brightness. So if I decrease this, it's going to make it darker. And so if I set this down to something like 0, you can see how this is really enhancing the level of detail we have here. To show you before and after, I'll just set this value back to 1, which is the default. And you can really see a difference now. Like I mentioned, that's not the only method. So what I'll do is I'll left click my mix node and press shift D. And this method is using the multiply. So we can change this from mix here to multiply. And then what I can do, if I plug my diffuse brick into the A socket, and then I'll plug my AO into the B socket. You'll now notice when I put this to 0 and then I'll plug my result into the surface, you'll notice we have our plain diffuse texture. And as I increase the factor higher and higher, you can see it's going to bring more of our ambient occlusion in like that. Both these methods are pretty good and which one you prefer is really up to you. For now, I'm just going to get rid of the other method. So I'll just left click this mix node here and then shift left click this hue saturation value node and then press X to delete them. And now we can go ahead and plug this into our shader. So I'm going to plug my result into the base color and then I'm going to plug my BSDF into the surface. And there, now we have our result and you can notice how this looks a lot more intense. It can be great for really adding some extra character to your models. I'm maybe going to set my factor though to something a little bit lower, like 0.7. There, that looks pretty good. And yeah, that just about covers it. I hope you enjoyed this module. Feel free to share your results in the community if you'd like to, as I'd love to see how you got on with this module. Apart from that though, I'd like to thank you so much for watching this module, and I'll see you later. Take care.